So welcome to this class on geometric phase. Okay, so there is a subtitle to this, which is from magnetic monopoles to falling cats. Okay, and you'll see how these appear in this talk. So we saw a couple of classes ago that there is something called the adiabatic theorem. Which basically says that if you have a Hamiltonian which is varying in time, very slowly, so that its instantaneous eigenvalues are always non-degenerate, that means there's a finite gap separating any two eigenvalues, instantaneous eigenvalues of H, then if we start in the nth state, we will always stay in the nth state. Okay, so even though the nth state can change with time, the instantaneous eigenvalues can change in time, but whatever that state is, we will stay there. So if we start in the ground state, we'll always stay in the ground state. If we start in the first excited state, we'll always stay in the first excited state. Okay, so let me give you the example that I'll discuss for most of today's talk. So it's just a spin half or a two-level system. Okay, so we'll consider a system like some vector small b, which is a function of time, times the three Pauli matrices. Now, this could be a description of a spin half in a magnetic field which is varying in time, right? So, you know, for a spin half object in a magnetic field, your Hamiltonian is minus g, how does it go? Q over twice mc S dot B. Okay, and S is, if it's spin half, then S is H bar sigma by 2. Okay, so this is exactly the kind of Hamiltonian that we have here. I've just replaced all these parameters here by this small b. Okay, but it doesn't have to be a spin half in a magnetic field. There are lots of two-level systems which are described by Hamiltonians of this kind. In fact, if you have a two-level system, the Hamiltonian has to be of this kind because it has to be a 2x2 Hamiltonian, and then the Hamiltonian has to be Hermitian, so it has to be a linear combination of the Pauli matrices, plus maybe the identity, but the identity is not going to be important in this talk. Okay, so let's consider this Hamiltonian. Now, this B is a vector in three dimensions, so it has three components. And so this Hamiltonian takes the form, if I write it out in terms of all these components, bz, these are all functions of time, so let me parameterize these three quantities bx, by, bz in the following way. So bx, by, bz will be some b times So I'm just using the polar coordinates, sine theta cos phi, sine theta sine phi cos theta. Okay. And B is positive square root of BX squared plus BYZ, BY squared plus BZ squared. Okay, so then given this Hamiltonian, you can easily show that H has instantaneous eigenvalues. B and minus B. And the corresponding normalized eigenvectors are in terms of these angles theta and phi, cosine theta by 2, sine theta by 2 e to the power I phi, and minus sine theta by 2 e to the power minus I phi cosine theta by 2. Okay, so now imagine that you start at time t equal to 0 in this state, which has eigenvalue plus b. Then as you vary all these parameters in time, you'll always stay in the state with the larger eigenvalue, which is plus b. Okay, so that's the adiabatic theorem. Okay, so if you start in the state with eigenvalue the plus b, we will always stay there. This is of course assuming that the two eigenvalues remain non-degenerate, and that will happen if b does not pass through the origin, right? So this is assuming that b t is never equal to 0. So that these two eigenvalues are separated by a finite amount, which is twice b. Okay, so we know that if the Hamiltonian is varying very slowly in time, it will always stay in the state with eigenvalue plus b, let's say. So the important question is, so that is the state, what is the phase of the wave function? Okay, because typically the phase will also change with time. Even if you had a time independent Hamiltonian, the phase changes in time as e to the power minus I e t by h bar, right? So what is a similar statement here where the Hamiltonian is varying in time? Okay. So we'll not deal with that, because then the two eigenvalues become degenerate and you have this level crossing, and none of what I'm going to say will hold. Okay. Okay, so what is the phase of the wave function, which is psi of t? So of course we know that psi, since by the adiabatic theorem we know that we are always going to be in the state psi plus. So I have to give these names. Let me call this psi plus and I'll call this psi minus. So we know that psi is proportional to psi plus, which is itself a function of time, because you know theta and phi are going to vary in time. But it could be psi plus times a phase. So let me just call it e to the I alpha of t. Okay. Now, there is one part of the phase which is very obvious, because as I said, if there's an energy E, the phase has to vary as e to the minus I e t by h bar. Now here, of course, your energy plus B can vary with time, right? Because this B can be a function of time. So we expect that alpha t will have term like, okay, like what? So normally it would have been minus 1 over h bar e times t, right, if the energy was constant in time. But here the energy is not, I shouldn't say energy, the instantaneous eigenvalue B is a function of time. So instead of that, you'll actually get minus 1 by h bar. Say you're starting at some time 0, t equal to 0, to t equals capital T dt of B of t. Okay. So this is the equivalent of this expression when this eigenvalue B is changing with time. Okay. And we'll see in a little while that this is actually correct. There is a phase like that in this wave function psi. Okay, so we'll come to this in a minute. So this is called the dynamical phase. Okay, and every wave function will always have this, simply because, you know, it has an energy, and so there is a part of the phase which varies as roughly the integral of the energy times time. Now the big surprise is that this is not the only thing that you have, and there is an extra phase that appears, and that's the phase that was first discovered by Berry. Okay, so let me erase all this. So in addition to the dynamical phase, there is another phase so I have to give this a name. Let me call gamma, which was discovered by Berry. And the surprising thing is that this discovery came only in 1984, so almost 60 years after the beginning of quantum mechanics. A really new discovery was made in quantum mechanics. Okay? So if you want to read Berry's original paper, Proceedings of Royal Society of London, volume 392, 1984, and page number 45. He actually wrote a series of papers, but this is probably the best one to read. Now it turns out that several years before, there was a person named Pancharatnam working in RRI down the road, who discovered a similar phase in the context of optics. Okay. Now we'll discuss that a little bit. I'll not really talk about the Pancharatnam phase because I don't have enough time for it. But basically, you'll see that optics, or generally electromagnetic radiation, is like a spin 1 problem, because photons have spin 1, whereas right now we are discussing spin half. But the basic idea is the same. Even in optics, when you do something which I'll describe later, the wave function changes by a phase. Okay? And that was discovered by Pancharatnam many years before Berry. But in some sense, Pancharatnam's discovery was purely in the context of optics, whereas Berry's work was more general. It covered all of quantum mechanics. But Berry himself is very gracious, and he started calling it the Pancharatnam phase. So today it's called the Berry-Pancharatnam phase. Or more commonly, it's just called the geometric phase. And you'll see why it's called the geometric phase. Okay, so let's see what this phase is equal to. So we're going to assume that the wave function has three pieces. One piece is psi plus, which is that column, cosine theta by 2, sine theta by 2, e to the I phi. Then there's a piece which is the dynamical phase, minus I by h bar. And we are only going to look at, So I'm going to start at time t equal to 0 and go up to time t. B of t prime plus some I gamma of t. Okay, so there are two parts to the phase. There's a dynamical phase and there's a geometric phase, and you'll see why it's called geometrical phase. So let's try to derive this expression for gamma. So notice that I've already simplified the situation a bit by assuming that psi is always proportional to psi plus. It doesn't have any psi minus component. That's because of the adiabatic theorem, right? So in general, if the variation of the Hamiltonian was not slow, psi at a general time would have a linear superposition of psi plus and psi minus, but I've already used adiabatic theorem to say that it only has a component along psi plus. But psi still has to satisfy the Schrodinger equation, right? So psi has to satisfy the equation I h bar d psi by dt is h psi, where psi and h as well are both functions of time. So what we do is that we substitute this form for psi in this equation. Okay, so now you can see that on the left hand side you'll get several terms, because this del by del t can act on psi plus of t, it can act on this phase, or it can act on this phase. Okay, so we have to write down all of those terms. So del psi plus by del t, and these phases I'll take it outside the bracket common. And this is going to be h. Okay, so now, so the first term is del psi plus by del t. The second term is this del by del t acting on this brings down b of t. So I should take the I h bar inside. Plus b of t. And then there is a term where this del by del t acts on that. So that's a minus gamma h bar del by del t. Is that fine so far? Okay. Now on the right hand side, again let me just open out psi, and so this is h t psi plus of t e to the power minus I by h bar 0 to t dt prime p t prime plus I gamma of t. Okay. Yes, in fact there will be a psi plus. So all of these terms have a psi plus in them. So is that fine so far? Something. Okay, let me just go on. Now on the right hand side, this psi plus by definition is an eigenstate of H with eigenvalue B. So this is just equal to B of T psi plus of T, right? So remember that psi plus is an instantaneous eigenstate of H with eigenvalue psi P B of T. Okay, so that piece cancels. Okay, so now we are left with an equation which is, I don't want to erase that. So now we are left with an equation which is I h bar d psi plus by dt minus h bar del gamma by del t psi plus is 0. Is that fine? So just the first term and the third term is equal to 0. Okay, so any questions so far?
What was the logic behind giving this gamma phase suddenly? So why very suddenly?
So let's put it in and see what happens. If it turns out to be zero at the end, fine.
It's a back check.
It's not a back check. We're just trying something. If it turns out to be zero, fine. You know. You always have to try new things, right?
So you can put I gamma and I chi also.
One phase is enough, right? I mean, you can include everything in gamma. Okay, so the equation that you have is the h bar cancels over there, so I del psi plus by del t is equal to del gamma by del t. This is a function of time, and then there's psi plus. Okay, so now this will tell us what gamma is. Okay, so let's calculate what gamma is. So how do you do that? So on this side, you have the derivative in time of some two-component object. Here, this is an ordinary function of time, times a two-component object. You want to get rid of the two-component object, right? So you take the inner product of both sides with psi plus dagger. So take inner product. On both sides, and use the fact that psi plus dagger, psi plus is 1 for all times, right? So that's how psi plus was normalized. Okay, so what we get is I psi plus dagger del psi plus by del t is del gamma by del t. Okay, so now remember that psi plus had this expression cosine theta by 2, sine theta by 2 e to the power I phi. And these are all functions of time, right? Because this B vector is going to change in time in some arbitrary way. So this is theta of t, this is theta of t, this is phi of t. So if you calculate I psi plus dagger del psi by del t, so let's see what do you get. You get cosine theta by 2, sine theta by 2, e to the power minus I phi. I del by del t of cosine theta by 2, sine theta by 2, e to the power plus I phi. So if you do this calculation, it's a simple calculation to do, you'll find that the derivatives of theta cancel with each other. Because you get cos theta by 2 times sin theta by 2 with a minus sign, plus sin theta by 2 times cos theta by 2 with a plus sign. Those will cancel out. You'll only be left with the derivative of phi. So if you work it out, you'll get minus sin squared theta by 2. And then e to the minus I phi with e to the I phi will cancel out. You'll get del phi by del t. Or actually, del phi by del t. Okay, so in principle, you can, and this is supposed to be equal to del gamma by del t. Okay, so in principle, you can integrate this over time to find out what gamma is. Assuming that you start with a zero phase at time t equal to zero, you just integrate this and find what gamma is at some later time t. So at this point, it's useful to draw a picture. Here's a sphere, and we are using polar coordinates. So you're at some point, which is theta phi. And this theta phi are varying in time. So you're going from here to some other point. So here you are at time t equal to 0, and here you're at time t equal to capital T. So I'm just going from t equal to 0 to capital T and try to find the change in phase. Notice that in this calculation, the magnitude of B doesn't matter at all, right? So it's only theta and phi which are important. So already it's simplified quite a bit. It doesn't depend on the magnitude of, if you had a magnetic field, it doesn't depend on the magnitude of that. It only depends on the direction, theta and phi, and how that is changing in time. Now it turns out that if we have an open curve, right, which means that theta phi at t equal to 0 and t equal to t are not the same, then gamma is not unique. And that's because, you know, you're always free to do a gauge transformation, right? At any point, you can multiply the wave function by some arbitrary phase, and you can multiply it by completely different phases at this point and at this point. And if you do that, then, you know, the value of gamma will change. Okay, so gamma basically is not gauge invariant if this curve is open, right? So start somewhere and end somewhere else. So the only way you get a well-defined phase is if you take a closed curve. Okay, so let's do that. So gamma is well-defined for a closed curve. Okay, so in your picture, you're starting somewhere and going around and coming back there. This is the theta phi coordinates on the surface of a sphere. Okay, so that's the phase that we are going to calculate. So notice that, you know, you might as well just live on the surface of a unit sphere. Since the magnitude of B is not important, we can just restrict our attention to the surface of a unit sphere so that the radius is just 1 and we just look at theta and phi. Okay, so we still have this problem of how to calculate this object, d gamma, this integral 0 to capital T is minus sine squared theta by 2, which is function of time, d phi 0 to capital, 0 to capital T. This is the final and initial values of time. Okay, so now it doesn't quite look very obvious how to do this integral. It's a closed integral, by the way, closed curve. Okay, so here's a trick for evaluating this integral. So the trick is the following. So you think of, you map this problem to the problem of a particle moving on the surface of a sphere with some charge q, speed of light c, Planck constants h-bar, and you identify this integral with the line integral of some vector potential, a dot dr going around that sphere. Okay? So you define this to be a dot dl around that closed curve. So basically, let's say you have an A which is of the form some theta hat A of theta. So we have to do everything in polar coordinates in terms of theta and phi, plus phi hat sine theta, phi hat A phi. And dl is theta hat d theta plus phi hat sine theta d phi. Okay, so now you can calculate A dot dl, and this has to be equal to that. So you discover that, okay, so A dot dl is just A theta d theta plus sine theta A phi d phi, and this thing has to be equal to minus sine squared theta by 2 times d phi. So that tells you that A theta is 0 and A phi is minus sine squared theta by 2 divided by sine theta. Okay, not quite. So I missed out some factors. So with this, we are basically talking about the Aronoff-Bohm phase, right? A particle, charged particle moving around in the presence of vector potential. But the phase picked up in the Aronoff-Bohm phase is this times q by h bar c. Okay, it doesn't matter, you'll see that it cancels out at the end. But let me just put that in, otherwise you may get very confused. So there's a factor of okay, so that's your the vector potential. So now this thing is also going to be equal to q by h bar c. You can use Stokes' theorem. So it'll be the integral of the magnetic field, right, coming out of in that direction through this, the part of this surface of the unit sphere which is bounded by this closed curve, right? So B dot ds. Okay, so now let's calculate the magnetic field. So the magnetic field is the curl of A. And in general, this is a very complicated object in polar coordinates, but we are lucky that we only have an A phi, we don't have an A theta, and the A phi is only a function of theta. So it turns out that this actually has a very simple expression, is R hat by sine theta d by d theta of sine theta A of phi. Okay. So you can do that calculation very easily, and this is what you get at the end of that calculation. So there's an hbar c over q that I have to carry over in the r hat direction into a minus half. So you get a very simple expression. So what kind of magnetic field is this? So wherever you are, it's pointing radially outwards. Okay, so this is the magnetic field of a magnetic monopole. So the surface of the sphere, you have this magnetic field coming out radially everywhere. Okay, so we have not discovered any magnetic monopoles in real life, in nature, but in the expression for periphase, it's convenient to introduce a magnetic monopole mathematically. Now that you have that term, you can easily figure out what this phase is. So now this phase gamma is q by h bar c b dot ds. D is minus h bar c by 2 q r, and ds is r times d omega, right? That is the surface, the unit vector normal to the surface times the solid angle. So if you put everything together, it's minus half omega, okay, which is the solid angle enclosed by the curve, the closed curve. So you remember what the closed curve is, right? It's the closed curve that is created by moving this B vector in time adiabatically. So notice that this is a very, very simple expression. It's a completely geometrical expression. It just depends on the solid angle. Does not depend on the magnetic, the magnitude of the magnetic field. Does not even depend on H bar. Okay, it's just a dimensionless number. It of course depends on this closed curve because it depends on the solid angle. Okay, so that's the derivation of the periphase for this spin half problem. So any questions so far? It just comes out of the calculation. You should just do it and you'll get it. So remember that A phi is sine squared theta by 2 by sine theta. Something like, yeah. So you get a half just from that calculation.
In Pancharatnam phase, when we take a photon, spin one particle,
you see. So I'll not talk about the Pancharatnam phase here, but now I'll talk about photons. Okay. So you get some idea of what the Pancharatnam phase is, though I won't directly talk about the Pancharatnam phase. Yeah. So then this calculation is going to break down, because then your psi will have some component in the other state, psi minus. Right? So here the whole assumption was that you're always in the state psi plus, and the only thing that can change is the phase. But if you can make transitions to psi minus, then it's a more complicated story. So then of course this will not work. Yeah, so as I said, for an open curve, it's not gauge invariant. For a closed curve, it's gauge invariant. Okay. Okay, so now this was the case for a spin half object. So by the way, this was the case, this is the phase you pick up when your state was the one with that had the higher eigenvalue plus b. If you take the state with the lower eigenvalue minus b, you just get the opposite sign. Okay. Now let me generalize this to the case where you have an h which is some s dot b, where this s is some arbitrary spin. So s squared is s into s plus 1 h bar squared. Okay. So far we have discussed spin half. So let's do it for a general spin now. So we discover that. So now of course if there is a spin s object in a field B which is varying in time, then of course there are 2s plus 1 states. So if you think of the state with sz equal to plus s h bar, you discover that gamma is minus s into omega. If it's sz equal to minus h bar, then gamma is plus s omega. And in general, gamma is just minus sz over h bar times omega. So that's the general expression for the Berry phase for any spin in the presence of a time-varying vector field. Okay, so now this has a neat application for electromagnetic radiation. So the application is as follows. So it turns out that photons have s in the direction of propagation equal to plus h bar or minus h bar. They don't have the other possible spin angular momentum, zero. That's not allowed for photons, but it can have plus h bar or minus h bar. So they're spin one particles, but only two of the three values are allowed. And it's in the direction of propagation. So if the direction of propagation changes, then in general the spin will also have to change its direction. This is in the quantum picture. In the classical language, plus h bar corresponds to right circularly polarized light. And minus h bar corresponds to left circularly polarized light. So we'll see this in detail later in the course when I talk about second quantization of electromagnetic radiation. So imagine now that you have light propagating along an optical fiber, right? So you have an optical fiber going up and the light just propagates in that direction. So you can have either kind of light, right circularly polarized or left circularly polarized. The other thing you learn in second quantization is that the wave function for light or electromagnetic radiation is actually just the vector potential. Okay. So we don't need to introduce a new wave function for light. It just turns out to be the vector potential, A. So let's say we are moving in the z direction. Then if it's x polarized light, then A will be of the form x hat e to the cosine kx minus omega t. If it's y polarized, it's going to be A equal to y cosine kz. Sorry, this is in the z direction. Minus omega t and so on. Right? So omega is equal to ck. So that's for linearly polarized light. What about circularly polarized light? So the right circularly polarized light has A equal to x cosine kz minus omega t plus, now I have to figure this out, I think it's minus y hat sine kz minus omega t. And if it's left circularly polarized, then it'll be x hat cosine plus y hat sine. Okay, now you can combine all these things into a more general expression, which is like this. So A is the imaginary part of some direction which tells you the polarization, times e to the power I kz minus omega t. Okay, so for example, if you had x polarized, this would be imaginary part of x hat e to the power I kz minus omega t, and that will just give you what I wrote there, x hat cosine kz minus omega t. If you want right circularly polarized light, you'll have to do the following. You'll have to take x hat plus I y hat e to the power I kz minus omega t. And then if you take the imaginary part of this whole thing, then it will give you that right circularly polarized thing that I wrote there. Okay. So now imagine the following situation, that you have this optical fiber, but it's not going straight up. It's slowly twisting. Okay, but very slowly, kind of adiabatically. So it's sort of doing like this. It's a little hard to draw, but think of a screw, right? It's sort of doing this as it's going up. Then, as I said, because it's adiabatic, if something is right circularly polarized, it'll always be right circularly polarized along the direction that it's moving, but the direction is slowly changing. So if you think of this direction is changing slowly on the surface of the sphere, right? For every turn of the optical fiber, it does a closed curve. Okay. So what we are doing is we send in X polarized light. So in the beginning, A looks like imaginary part of X hat e to the power I kz minus omega t, which is, so I'm going to write it now as a linear superposition of right circularly polarized and left circularly polarized. Yeah. It's coiled on something. But the twisting is very, very gradual. Let's say over the scale of one, okay, in some units, doesn't matter. Okay. So I'll write this as x hat plus I y hat plus x hat minus y I y hat half times e to the power I k z minus omega t. Okay, so this is what the vector potential, which is the wave function of light, looks like. But when it goes through this slightly twisted optical fiber, and this direction, the tangential direction to the fiber, is doing this slow turn on the surface of the sphere, let's say from the beginning till the end, it covers a solid angle omega. Okay? So let's say omega is a solid angle enclosed by the direction vector of the light on the unit sphere. If there are n turns, omega will be just n times the solid angle for each turn. So what will happen as a result of all that? So what happens is that after this turn by omega, A will be imaginary part of half x hat plus I y hat. This picks up a very phase of e to the minus I omega, right? And then the other part, which is half x hat minus I y hat e to the power I omega, so that picks up a berry phase of e to the plus I omega times e to the power I kz minus omega t. So if you work out all this, you get x hat cosine phi cosine omega plus y hat sine omega times cosine kz minus omega t. So the net result of all this is that the direction of polarization is still linearly polarized, but the direction of polarization rotates by an angle omega. Okay, even though it's not interacting with any medium as such. So somehow this twisted optical fiber acts like an optically active medium. Okay, but this effect is purely geometrical. It's just because, you know, the unit the direction of propagation is slowly changing on the unit sphere, and therefore the wave function changes by this Berry phase. And the important thing is that the change in the Berry phase is opposite for right circularly polarized and left circularly polarized. So if you are interested, you can look this up. This experiment was done, and so I'll give you the reference for this. And it was actually done very soon after Berry's work. So Tomita and Chiao, phase drive letter, 1986. So just 2 years after Berry's work. Okay. No, gamma is equal to the Berry phase is equal to the solid angle for a spin one particle, which is right circularly polarized, and is minus gamma for right circularly polarized plus gamma plus omega for. After this direction has changed by a solid angle omega. Is this clear what I did just now? Yeah. This is a total solid angle. So you can amplify this effect by having lots of turns, which is what these people did. I mean, they had lots and lots of turns to really amplify this effect. Right? So it's a total solid angle that is covered by this repeated movement of this direction of propagation. Okay. So let me try to give you a classical demonstration of this, because it's actually not a very hard concept. Okay. And the reason a classical demonstration is possible is that for spin 1 transforms in exactly the same way under rotations as ordinary vectors x, y, z. So spin 1 is, has three components in general, transforms in the same way under rotations as a classical vector. Okay, so I can show this effect very easily. So it's like this. So imagine that, so this, my fingers point in the direction of propagation. Okay, and then the direction of propagation changes. So I do this, for example. I move up by 90 degrees, come down by 90 degrees, and come back there. Okay, so to draw a picture of this, so I'm starting somewhere, then I'm going up, then I come down by in a direction which is 90 degrees away from this, and then I come back there. And these are all 90 degrees. As you know, this is possible because we are on the surface of a sphere. Okay, so it's clear what we are doing, right? So starting like this, going up, doing that, and then coming back. So how much is the solid angle? It's pi by 2. Because if you think about it, this is 1/8 of the entire solid angle, right? So the omega here is 1/8 of the full solid angle 4 pi, so it's pi by 2. Okay, so I have not yet shown you that pi by 2. So far I have just shown you the direction of propagation. Now I have to show you the polarization. So let me use my thumb for the polarization. So my thumb is naturally perpendicular to the direction of propagation, right? So this will be polarized in some way, this will be polarized 90 degrees to that, and so on. Okay, so watch my thumb. So this is pointing up. So when I do this whole thing, it should turn by pi by 2, right? Because the whole point is that polarization turns by the same angle as the solid angle. Okay, so this pointing up, so I do this. I'm kind of parallel transporting it. Right, so it goes there. Then I come down, and then I bring it back. So this is turned by pi by 2. I didn't cheat. I mean, I didn't twist my arm or anything. This is the most natural thing to do, is pointing vertically up. I do that, come down, and then bring it back. Okay, so that's an example of Berry phase of pi by 2 for spin 1 object. Now it turns out that this geometric phase is a very general concept, and once Berry did his work, then people realized that there are many things that were already known which were actually examples of geometric phase, but they didn't realize it like that earlier. So let me give you two examples where something like the geometric phase had already appeared before. So what is the main message of the geometric phase? So the main message of the geometric phase is the following. That if the parameters of a system are changed so as to take them around a closed curve, so nothing happens to the system, right? So this was an example of that. So I started here, went up, came down. So finally, my hand was pointing the same direction as what it was. So that's like a closed curve for my, as far as my hand is concerned. But something changed. In this case, the direction of the thumb changed. So if the parameters of the system are changed so as to take them around a closed curve, some property of the system may change. And which property it is that changes depends on the system. Okay, so let me give you two examples. One example you already know very well, which is the Foucault's pendulum. Right. So this is this thing that, you know, you hang a pendulum, and slowly the plane of oscillation of the pendulum rotates. And if you wait 24 hours, so after 24 hours, everything has the Earth has rotated by 360 degrees. So nothing has changed as far as the Earth is concerned. But the plane of the pendulum has changed by a little bit. Right? So at a latitude theta, so where theta is defined to be, theta is 0 at the North Pole. It's pi by 2 at the equator and pi at the South Pole. That's the natural definition in spherical polar coordinates. It's not the definition used in latitude. The latitude, the equator is 0, North Pole is 90 degrees, South Pole is minus 90 degrees. At a latitude theta, the plane of oscillations rotates by, do you remember the expression? It's a very simple expression. 2 pi cosine theta in 24 hours. Okay, so that's an example of a geometric phase, that even though in 24 hours the Earth has come back to the same orientation that it had, the orientation of the plane of oscillation has changed by a certain amount. So it changes by 2 pi at the North Pole and at the South Pole. It doesn't change at all at the equator. Actually, the fact that it changes by 2 pi at the North and South Pole is very easy to understand. Normally, when you derive this, you use all this complicated stuff about Coriolis force and so on. But something very simple happens at the North and South Pole, which is that, imagine that you're looking down from the North Pole. There's this thing oscillating. So nothing, of course, acts on it, right? There's no force, real force acting on this. So it's just oscillating in the same plane. But underneath it, the Earth is rotating, right? So after 24 hours, the Earth has rotated by 2 pi. So it looks like the plane of this pendulum with respect to the Earth has rotated by 2 pi. Okay, so there's nothing very mysterious actually about the rotation of the Foucault's pendulum. The second and last example that I'll talk about is actually my favorite. And this is the example of a falling cat. So if you have not seen a YouTube video of a falling cat, please do this after this class. It's absolutely fascinating what cats do. So suppose you take a cat and drop it upside down, okay? Then it always manages to land up the proper way up, right? Of course, it has to be dropped from a certain height. If you drop it too close to the ground, it doesn't have time to flip over. And if you drop it from too high, then of course, that's the end of it. So there's an optimal height from which you have to drop the cat so that it just manages to turn by pi. So now this is actually a very complicated story, how the cat manages to do this, right? I can't resist drawing a cartoon. So here's the cat. Okay, and you're dropping it. So if you look at these videos, you discover that what the cat does, so what is special about a cat is that it has a very flexible spine and it can bend its body, right? So while it's falling, it'll have a completely different shape, you know, it'll have a shape like that kind of. And these two parts of the body actually rotate in different directions. And it does this for a brief amount of time such that, so each part of the body has an orbital angular momentum. But the total orbital angular momentum of the cat has to be zero because there's no external torque acting on it. Right? So there's no external torque. And so the total angular momentum of the cat has to be zero at all times. But that doesn't prevent different parts of the body from having some angular momentum. So what it does is that this is the usual shape of a happy cat, right? And when it lands on the ground again, it has the usual shape. So in between, it is actually going through a distortion of the body. So in terms of the parameters of the body, that's a parameter space. It's doing a closed curve in that, right? It's starting from some shape and ending in the same shape. So that's the equivalent of the closed curve. So the body shape, the body goes through a closed curve in the space of shapes. Okay, now this is a highly abstract space, right? It is a space with infinite number of parameters if you really think about it. But that's what it does. And the net effect of all this is that the shape of the body comes back to what it is, but the orientation has changed by pi. Right? So that's what the cat does, right? So at the end, the orientation of the cat Right, so if it was pointing the wrong way up, it just turns around by half a full rotation, and so that it is pointing the right way down. Okay, so that's the story of the falling cat. Now, in case you're thinking I'm joking, there is actually an article about this which you're welcome to read. So take a look at this article, Shapier, and we'll check. American Journal of Physics, 57, 1989, page 514. So generally articles in the American Journal of Physics are easy to read. They're actually meant for beginning PhD students, that level. So they're not very complicated. So they discuss this thing that how different creatures, or generally, you know, different objects can change their shape so as to achieve something that they want to. This is not the only example. There are also bacteria which swim at very low Reynolds number. They swim through water. So what they do is that they change their body shape in a very complicated way, right? And so they start with some shape and end up with the same shape. But in the process, they have moved forward a little bit, okay? So it's fun to look at videos of those. So they're doing these very complicated things, and at the end of one cycle, they've just moved forward a little bit. Okay. So let me just end with a general reference. By the way, Wilczek is a Nobel laureate, right? He got the Nobel Prize for theory of strong interactions, something called asymptotic freedom, showing that strong interactions become weak at very large energies. And after doing all that work, he saw the light and moved to condensed matter physics. Okay. So there's a book called Shapir, same people, Shapir and Wilczek. Also the same person who came up with the name anions, right? Fractional statistics particles. Geometric phases in physics. So it's a collection of articles that you can look at. Publisher is World Scientific, 1989, I think Singapore. Okay, so that's all I wanted to say. If you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer them. Yeah. So if it's spinless, then it's the wave function is just a single component. So it has 2s plus 1 component. So if s is not 1, then you can't identify them directly with x, y, z. That's true.
What do you mean by solid angle in that?
No, the solid angle is not for the spin, it's for this vector B of t. Okay, so the idea is so we have a Hamiltonian which is some spin dot B of t. So it is this B which is changing in time. Right? So we are following B. And the direction of B is basically doing some closed curve which encloses some solid angle with respect to the origin of that sphere. So the solid angle is for B, it's not for the spin.
Okay. With the most general Hamiltonian, you can write this. Each level can have a separate energy.
Sure, yes.
In that case, do we have an analog?
Yeah. So this Berry phase works for every level separately. So the general formula is that the Berry phase of let's say the state with one particular value, let's say with Sz equal to some m hbar is minus m omega. Okay, so I may have left you a little mystified. So I'm assuming that you start in a state which has Sz equal to minus m omega. So otherwise, how would you know which direction is Sz? So imagine that you start with a state where this B, okay, so let me specify this. Let's say at time t equal to 0, B is in the Z direction. Okay, so at that point, you can label the states by values of Sz, right? Okay, so then choose a state with Sz equal to some m hbar. Then as B changes in time to come back to its initial value, Bsz at time capital T, you discover that the Berry phase picked up by this state is minus m omega. Okay, so I hope that makes it clear. So you have to know the initial state to know which value of m that you're in. Okay, now let me say something more, because this is also an interesting point. So you know that on the surface of the sphere, the solid angle that I have defined for you, it depends on the way you go around the curve, right? It's one way. If you go around the curve this way, you'll get one solid angle. If you go around the other way, you'll get minus omega, right? Because it's the surface integral of B dot S. Now, somebody might object and say that, how do you know whether the solid angle that you have covered is this much rather than the other one, the complement of it, right? So you can say that the solid angle covered is omega, or 4 pi minus omega. Okay, but if you took the other one, would you get a different Berry phase? Okay, so let's try this out. Now if you think of going around the closed curve this way and cover the solid angle omega, if you think of it not as covering this solid angle but covering the rest, then the rest is covered in the opposite direction, right? B dot ds is the opposite direction. So the solid angle for the rest is actually minus of this thing. Now let's calculate the berry phase and see if we get different answers. So if you think of the first case, then you pick up a berry phase of minus I m omega. If you think of the same second case, the berry phase e to the power minus I m 4 pi minus omega, actually plus because there's a minus sign in front, which is e to the power minus I m omega plus I 4 pi m. Okay, now here's an interesting fact. Any component of the spin is always an integer or a half integer, and therefore 4 pi m is just a multiple of 2 pi, so it makes no difference. So this is the same as e to the power minus m omega. Because m is always an integer or half integer. So that's quite amazing. The berry phase somehow knows that the only values of the spin component in any direction that is allowed are integers or half integers. If they were not, you would not get a consistent answer at the end of your calculation. There was a question? Yeah.
Berry phase, you derived m solid angle by half.
So that was for the spin half case. So that was for the spin half case. Then I just stated that for the general case, it's m times minus m times omega, where m is the component of spin. So for the spin half case, it's minus omega by 2. Yeah.
We have the magnitude of B constant.
No, it doesn't have to be. The magnitude of B doesn't enter anywhere in the calculation. So the magnitude of B actually can change in time. So it's only the angle theta and phi which matters. So, curve, it can actually go up out of this unit sphere. It can go out, and then as long as it comes back to the same point that it started, you are fine. So since the magnitude of B that makes no difference, I just ignored that and did everything on the surface of a unit sphere.
While doing that optical fiber experiment, so you have taken some origin to calculate this omega, right?
So you imagine that you are starting with something linearly polarized along the x direction when the light enters the optical fiber at the bottom. And then when it comes out at the top, it turns out that it rotates by some. It is basically the direction of linear polarization has rotated by some amount, which is equal to the total solid angle that the direction of propagation has changed by.
Okay, so now my question is, suppose this optical fiber itself is moving in some axis. Suppose the axis it is swirling around, it is moving along that axis. Now this omega will like decrease with time.
Yeah, so that's a more complicated story than if you move the optical fiber itself. That's not what they did. Experimentally, the optical fiber is fixed. It's just coiled around something so that the direction of propagation is slowly changing in time. The direction of propagation is changing in time, it's not because the optical fiber is moving in time. Huh. It's because the light is moving through the optical fiber.
Okay. Yeah, now my question is, suppose I am moving this optical fiber.
Yeah, I have no idea.
Okay.
This two-level system.
Yeah.
We can parameterize it with theta and phi.
So okay, yes.
So here, the car starts with a sphere. The closed car is on a sphere.
You really have to speak much louder. So falling cat is a much more complicated story. It's not a two-level system, right? It's actually, it has infinite degrees of freedom.
So you are saying infinite number of parameters.
Yes, yes.
So
there, it's a much more complicated space that we are talking about. Yeah. So you should take a look at this, that American Journal of Physics article, because they describe a general problem where this berry phase appears with a very large parameter space. It is definitely not a two-level system. Yeah, it's still a parallel transport in some complicated space. Yeah.
When the wire had one turn, you told that the polarization will change. Like, suppose it was in this polarization, it will be in polarization. Then now it's not in that polarization.
No, but you can just repeat that argument. You can just keep repeating that argument. If it turns by the direction of polarization changes by something by in one turn, it'll change by twice that amount after two turns, right? Because I can keep doing this thing several times, right? So there's nothing special about the initial polarization being in the x direction. Wherever it starts, after one turn, it turns, the polarization rotates by a certain amount. And then after 100 turns, it'll change by 100 times that amount. Okay. All right, then no other questions. Thank you for coming.